Now get the guns, the drugs, for my generation, I'll take the fall. The saints, the cross nation, and it's a sex. The gods, the freaks, the frauds, they're messing with me.
Welcome to May 20th, 1996, and welcome to the final Reliving the War of 2020. You know the drill, we're going to go back and compare matches and segments from WWF Raw and WCW Nitro to see which show was really the best. Raw is still showing taped matches from Sioux City, Iowa, while Nitro is live tonight from Monroe, Louisiana. This is a strange one. While not advertised nor announced, Nitro ran for nearly 1.5 hours this week, so the WCW matches and promos went a little long, but what I'll do here is just compare the segments as usual. Next week though, Nitro moves to a full 2 hour show, and I'll talk a little about how that affects Reliving the War at the end of this upload. Tonight is truly the end of an era for WCW, as a certain someone is going to declare war next week on Monday Nitro. Let's start things off then with the Slamboree results. Slamboree 1996 took place in Baton Rouge, Louisiana on May 19th, 1996. This was a themed pay-per-view. It was all about the Lethal Lottery Tag Team Tournament and the Battle Bowl Battle Royal that followed. Basically, it's all about random tag teams. Tag teams who win their second tournament match get put into the Battle Bowl, and the winner of the Battle Bowl gets a WCW title shot. There's 15 matches here. I'm not going to go over them all, but we'll look at the more prominent moments of the pay-per-view. Dean Malenko successfully defended the WCW Cruiserweight Championship in one of the better matches of the show. Conan also successfully defended the US title in a match with Jushin Thunder Liger, another pretty good match here that provided a nice palate cleanser for all the tag team matches that happened throughout the show. The first Lord of the Ring tournament match featured Road Warrior Animal teaming up with Booker T to take on Lex Luger and Road Warrior Hawk. It ended in a double countout when the Road Warriors joined forces to do battle with their tag partners. Lex Luger ended up walking away. Chris Benoit and Kevin Sullivan teamed up, but they took a loss to the Public Enemy. The Steiner Brothers were also forced to face each other when Scott Steiner teamed up with Sergeant Craig Pittman, and take a guess who Rick Steiner's partner was. I'll give you a clue. His name starts with asshole and it ends with man. Yeah, Ed Leslie himself, the Booty Man. And what do you know, Rick Steiner and the Booty Man got the win. Ric Flair and Randy Savage simply failed to cooperate when they took on Arn Anderson and Eddie Guerrero in their first round match. Flair and Anderson worked together even though they were on opposing teams. Anderson ended up giving Guerrero a DDT and the Enforcer allowed Flair to pin Eddie, so the Nature Boy and the Macho Man advanced. Flair and Savage would lose their second round match by forfeit though, when Savage attacked Slick Rick during the second round entrances. The Booty Man cost his team their second round match when he and Rick were defeated by Diamond Dallas Page and the Barbarian, and in the end, DDP would win the whole Battle Bowl. Page did get eliminated quite early in the match, but the referees didn't catch it, and the Battle Bowl came down to DDP and his partner for the evening, the Barbarian. Page scored the pinfall win after hitting the Diamond Cutter. The Giant successfully defended the World Heavyweight title in his match with Sting. Lex Luger cost Sting the match when he accidentally hit his partner with Jimmy Hart's megaphone. The Giant then hit the chokeslam for the victory. Slamboree 1996 won't win any pay-per-view of the year awards. The Cruiserweight and US title matches were decent, but with 15 matches to watch, it's a seriously overbooked wrestling event. Steve McMichael is not at the commentary desk for Monday Nitro. At Slamboree, Ric Flair and Arn Anderson challenged Mongo to a match, and Mongo announced that his partner would be none other than Kevin Green. Mongo and Green were in training for their tag team match at the Great American Bash, so no more close-ups of Pepe here on Reliving the War. Over on Raw, Vince McMahon opens up the show by saying some big things went down during a live show in Madison Square Garden, and we're going to get the details tonight on Raw. This New York live show also featured the curtain call, but the curtain call was not spoken of on WWF television. Our first matches then are Stone Cold Steve Austin versus Mark Merrow, and we have a rematch on Nitro. It's Fire and Ice versus the Steiner Brothers. The beginning of the Austin vs. Merrow match is another good example of how Steve Austin used to be a very different wrestler before his neck injury. It's all holds and mat wrestling to start things off here, with neither man really gaining the upper hand. We see wrist locks, arm bars and hammer locks. Austin tries to pick up the pace, but Merrow comes back with a flying crossbody before another arm bar gets applied. Stone Cold is able to hit a back elbow, the two men trade punches, and then Austin takes a few hip tosses followed by a shaky looking dropkick. Austin gets out of the ring to catch his breath, and when the match resumes, Stone Cold goes on the attack. A corner stun gun from Stone Cold looks great as the rattlesnake takes control. Merrow tries to fight back, but the wild man gets thrown out of the ring as we go to commercial break. Merrow's trying to make a comeback when we return, but Austin delivers a hard-hitting clothesline. Stone Cold follows up with another second rope elbow drop, and then Austin grabs a side headlock. Merrow gets out and the wild man goes for a sleeper, but Austin counters with a jawbreaker. Ted DiBiase is getting a little restless at ringside as a slugfest breaks out in the middle of the ring. Merrow hits a head scissors followed by a knee lift. The wild man goes to the top rope and he lands a big double axe handle. Austin kicks out at two. Merrow then begins firing up. Stone Cold takes a few shots in the corner, but Ted DiBiase distracts Merrow. This allows Austin to capitalize with a few clubbing blows and a few kicks. Stone Cold delivers a body slam before going to the top rope, and then Savio Vega shows up and he begins whipping Austin's back. The ref calls for the bell and Steve Austin wins via disqualification. The action inside the ring was solid here, the match was just let down by the finish. The Steiners vs. Fire and Ice won a point on the April 29th, 96 episode of Reliving the War, so let's see if they can do the same this week. Scott Steiner delivers an arm drag to Ice Train as Eric Bischoff announces that Macho Man Randy Savage once again got arrested last night at Slamboree. I think that's around 5 or 6 arrests in the space of a month now. Ice Train hits an arm drag of his own before applying a side headlock. Scott answers with a clothesline. The back and forth action continues with Ice Train hitting a clothesline of his own, and then Train takes a page out of Scotty Steiner's playbook by delivering a belly-to-belly suplex. Scott says, "Nah mate, fuck that, I don't think so." Ice Train takes an overhead belly-to-belly suplex, and you can just tell the Big Papa Pump was pleased with this spot. It made him feel great about himself, I'm sure. Scott Norton and the Dogface Gremlin get tagged in. Rick takes a beating in the corner before getting nailed with a clothesline. Norton delivers a top rope splash, and the punishment continues as Rick gets nailed with a running shoulder block and a few clotheslines. Just like his brother Scott, Rick says, "Nah mate, I don't think so, it's suplex time," and it looks like Norton takes the impact on his hand or his forearm. This could have been disastrous, but thankfully Big Flash Norton seems okay. Rick tags in Scott, a full Nelson suplex gets delivered, and it isn't as clean as Steiner would like. Norton gets thrown to the outside and Steiner hits a forearm from the turnbuckle to the outside. Again, it's a little shaky, but it finds its mark. Back inside the ring, Steiner ducks a clothesline, but he takes a Samoan drop. Train comes into the match, but he immediately gets hit with an exploder suplex. Rick and Ice Train are now in the ring and they take each other out with a double clothesline, and the match then breaks down with all four men fighting on the outside. Norton hits a shoulder breaker on Scott Steiner as the referee calls for the bell. It's a double countout. The dreaded WCW Nitro split screen rears its ugly head as all four men brawl around the ring. Scotty Steiner hits a weak looking belly to belly suplex while Rick and Train fight on the entranceway. This just wasn't as good as their first match, unfortunately. Austin vs. Merrow had a weak finish, but I felt the Raw match was still better. Eddie Guerrero wants a little payback for Slamboree next when he does battle with Ric Flair while the WWF presents Savio Vega versus the 1-2-3 Kid. The WWF shows some clips from their recent visit to Kuwait, and basically they want to show how over Ahmed Johnson was in the Middle East. So over was Ahmed Johnson that this kid started beating the shit out of himself while Ahmed made his entrance. The WWF continues to honour the Ultimate Warrior's contract by advertising the Warrior's comic book. book, Vince McMahon says this comic will revolutionize the industry as we see Warrior signing copies in New York. Ted DiBiase takes a seat at the commentary table as Vega and Kid begin their match. DiBiase is holding a chauffeur hat. Remember, Vega will become DiBiase's personal assistant if he loses the strap match at Beware of Dog. And gee, I wonder how this match is going to end. It's not like Vega didn't just interrupt a match 2 minutes ago. A lot of back and forth to start things off here. Vega takes control early on and the Kid gets taken out of the ring with a spinning wheel kick in the corner. Savio keeps the pressure on inside the ring with a drop kick followed by a chin lock. Not one chin lock, not two, but three times this gets applied. DiBiase taunts Vega from the announce table. This distracts Savio long enough for Kid to take advantage. Kid delivers his signature kick combination before hitting a drop kick in the corner. Waltman tells the audience to suck it before hitting a top rope splash. Jerry Lawler tells Ted DiBiase that Savio Vega could cook the Million Dollar Man some Puerto Rican chicken soup. DiBiase asks how this dish is made, and Lawler says you start by stealing two chickens. We go to break as Kid wrenches Savio's neck. Vega fights back, but he misses an elbow drop. Kid answers with a leg drop of his own, and then Savio takes a beating in the corner, but he begins hulking up. Kid is having none of it, and Vega takes a hard knife-edge chop to set him back down. A back kick nearly takes the 1-2-3 Kid's head off, and Savio hits a high-angle Sambo suplex. Kid answers with a back kick of his own. No one is really gaining any kind of advantage here. Kid misses a diving splash, and Savio wins the match with a unique pin, but it looks like Kid landed right on his head here. As expected, Steve Austin hits the ring after the match. Savio takes a beating from both Stone Cold and the Kid. Savio then gets tied up and embarrassed in the middle of the ring. Yeah, it was alright, nothing special. Guerrero vs Flair then on Nitro. Flair taunts the Macho Man by kissing Miss Elizabeth before the opening bell. Eddie applies a side headlock and he keeps the pressure on with a headlock takedown from the second rope. Guerrero lands a leapfrog dropkick sequence before once again going for a side headlock. Flair breaks it up by getting to the turnbuckles, and then both men trade punches and chops while travelling from corner to corner. Guerrero and Flair give as good as they get here as the match resets. Guerrero gives Flair a taste of his own medicine with some knife edge chops before the Nature Boy gets drop kicked over the top rope. Slick Rick walks over to his VIP area and he grabs a steel chair. Randy Anderson stops Flair from bringing the chair into the ring, and we get a little pushing match on the outside. The match resets for the second time and Guerrero takes control. The Nature Boy gets annoyed and he chases Eddie out of the ring. Eddie mocks Flair by performing the Nature Boy strut on the outside, and Flair is now pissed. This was a step too far. Slick Rick goes to attack Eddie in the ring, but Guerrero hits another hard knife edge chop, resulting in Flair taking the face first bump. Flair pokes Eddie in the eye as we go to commercial break. Bobby Heenan calls this a Greco-Roman thumb to the eye. And when we come back, Guerrero is fighting his way out of a standing crossface. Eddie hits a diving sunset flip, but it only scores him a two count. Flair hits his signature knee drop and another series of punches and chops gets traded in the corner. Guerrero manages a backslide pin and a small package, but Flair kicks out on both occasions. The Nature Boy hits a back body drop and he goes for the figure four, but Guerrero counters with another small package. Again, it's only a two count. The Nature Boy goes to punt Guerrero, but Guerrero grabs a foot and he locks in the figure four. Rick makes it to the ropes before rolling out of the ring. Guerrero smashes the guardrail when he attempts a dive from the top rope, and Flair follows up with a suplex on the mats. Rick then delivers a chop block and this causes Guerrero to begin favoring the leg. Eddie keeps fighting though. A tornado DDT gets followed up with a top rope Hurricane Rana. Eddie then hits the frog splash, but he can't follow up with a pin. There's too much damage to the leg. Flair goes for the kill. The figure four gets applied. Woman lends a helping hand and Guerrero's shoulders get counted to the mat. Flair versus Guerrero gets the point. This actually really should have been the main event. The Faces of Fear take on Sting in the Total Package next, while the WWF presents clips from their recent Madison Square Garden live show in a pallbearer interview. At the New York show held the night before, Sonny was seen inside the Godwin's locker room. It looked like Sonny was taking advantage of Phineas. Poor Phineas. A little later on, Sonny tried to distract Phineas during the Godwin's match with the Body Donnas, but the plan backfired and the Godwins became the new WWF Tag Team Champions. Vince McMahon announces that the Godwins will now defend the belts against the Smoking Guns in the Beware of Dog free-for-all. Paul Bearer is then interviewed by Jim Ross, and I'm sorry, they turned the lights off for this one. Paul Bearer said that Goldust crossed the line last week, and I'm not sure if he was referring to the Bizarre One feeling Paul's ass last week, or Goldust touching the little phenom. Goldust is going to feel the wrath of the Undertaker at Beware of Dog either way. Jim Ross says he'd like to speak with the Undertaker, and right enough, the Undertaker is in the casket behind Paul Bearer. Can't see shit here, but the Undertaker begins cutting a promo. Mankind and Goldust then show up, and while Goldust keeps Paul Bearer busy, Mankind ties the casket shut before coming back out with a large metal pole. Foley then goes to town on the casket before tipping it over, and the promo comes to an end. Not a lot to say here, really. The WWF were keeping focus on the Mankind vs. Undertaker rivalry, even though the Dead Man was scheduled to face Goldust at Beware of Dog. Kinda gives away what was going to happen in the casket match, but anyway, let's flip over to Nitro. Tag Team Champions Lex Luger and Sting take on Ming and the Barbarian. Ric Flair has joined the commentary team, and he's brought food, drinks, women and candles. What a great guy. Flair says that Heenan can touch the girls, but Bischoff can keep his hands to himself. And Flair also says that Ted Turner loves it when the Nature Boy shows up for commentary. Jane Fonda is also a Flair fan, apparently. Remember, Luger pretty much cost Sting the WCW Championship at Slamboree, so let's see what happens during this match. The tag titles are on the line here. Lex Luger and Ming start things off, and already Flair is proving to be a great commentator as he brags about beating guys like Wahoo McDaniel and Ernie Ladd. Slick Rick even compliments Lex Luger's ability to move his pecs on command. Ming makes quick work of Luger before the Barbarian gets tagged in. Sting comes into the match as we go to commercial break. Before cutting away, Flair sings "Where Oh Where Is Mongo McMichael?" and he also sings "Debbie Does the Nature Boy." Fantastic stuff. We come back and Ric Flair is singing once again as Sting performs a double arm drag. Have a listen.
Ric Flair. Ooh, do a little dance, make a little love, get down tonight, WCW.
Stinger, get down.
Sting applies a bear hug, but the Barbarian dodges the follow-up dropkick. Ming gets back in the ring, and as much as I love seeing Sting in WCW, these Luger and Sting matches are beginning to get seriously repetitive, with Sting needing to make the hot tag. The Faces of Fear begin making frequent tags, both legal and illegal. Sting takes an atomic drop and a big boot combination from Ming and the Barbarian, and then the Barbarian delivers an insane belly-to-belly suplex from the top rope. This looked pretty good. Sting keeps kicking out even though he's taking a beating here. The Faces of Fear hit tandem diving headbutts, but Luger distracts the referee when Ming goes for the pin. Sting begins to fire up a little, and he nearly makes the tag, but he's brought right back to the opposite corner. Ric Flair says that Kevin Green and Mongo McMichael should get put in a warm-up match with the Faces of Fear as the Barbarian misses a diving headbutt. This gives Sting the opportunity to make the hot tag, and even though I complained about these Luger and Sting matches always being the same recently, it still works very well. The crowd pops for the Total Package coming in and cleaning house. Eventually, Lex and Ming fight on the outside while Sting deals with the Barbarian. Sting hits a top rope splash and Luger dashes in to get the pinfall win. Bobby Heenan rightfully says that this doesn't make any sense. Sting's acting like Luger didn't get involved in the Slamboree title match, but still, it's a point for Nitro. After the bout, we see Macho Man Randy Savage outside the building. The cops aren't allowing Savage into the arena. Mean Gene says WCW officials are meeting to determine the future of Randy Savage. There's a good chance Savage could get fired for his recent actions. Savage shows his paranoia by accusing Mean Gene of setting him up. The Macho Man tries to get past the cops, but it's no use. Ric Flair laughs like a maniac on commentary while all this goes down. A video airs on Nitro that says our world is about to change. The words "Blood Runs Cold" gets displayed as some kind of portal opens up while frosting up the screen. Whatever this is, it's coming to WCW, and I can't wait to find out more next week. Up next, we have Battle Bowl winner Diamond Dallas Page taking on Brad Armstrong on Nitro, while Jim Cornette cuts a promo on Raw. I'll keep this Raw segment brief. Cornette is in the ring with Diana Hart, Davey Boy Smith, and Clarence Mason. Jim says that Diana Hart has now got a restraining order. Shawn Michaels can't come anywhere near Mrs. Davey Boy Smith, and therefore Shawn will not be able to commentate during Davey's main event match with Jake Roberts. Gorilla Monsoon comes to the ring, and after checking over the papers, Gorilla says it all looks legit and Shawn will indeed stay away from Diana. Gorilla then orders Diana to go backstage so Shawn can come out and provide commentary as promised. And this is exactly what happens. HBK walks out past Diana, Davey Boy is absolutely fuming, but Shawn takes his seat in preparation for tonight's main event. Over on Nitro, DDP debuts his Smells Like Teen Spirit rip-off theme music, but of course, this has been edited for the WWE Network. Armstrong stays on top of Page at the beginning of the match. Any offense that DDP brings gets reversed, but DDP is eventually able to hit Brad with a swinging neckbreaker. We come back from a commercial break to see Armstrong attempt a backslide, but Page kicks out. Bischoff reminds us that DDP will get a title shot at the Great American Bash next month on pay-per-view. Page says Armstrong into the corner, but Brad moves out of the way when Dallas tries to follow up. Brad begins bashing Page's head on the top turnbuckle, and Flair then puts over Armstrong on commentary. Flair says that Brad Armstrong is one of the very best professional wrestlers in the world, and you can tell Flair was being genuine here by his tone, plus the fact that Armstrong was the babyface and Flair, of course, is the dirtiest player in the game. Armstrong hits a top rope crossbody, but it only gets him a two count. Page then hits a back elbow followed by the diamond cutter to score the win. Mean Gene interviews Page after the match. DDP brags about winning the Battle Bowl. He gives himself the self high five, and DDP says he's coming after the Giant at the Great American Bash. Mean Gene says he just got off the phone to the WCW committee, and photos are shown of DDP's foot hitting the floor during the Battle Bowl. Mean Gene then says that the booking committee are taking away Page's title shot, and instead Lex Luger will get a match with the Giant at the Great American Bash. So yeah, the whole Lethal Lottery tournament was absolutely pointless. It was a short match here on Nitro, but it was still better than the Shawn Michaels stuff on Raw, so it's another point for WCW. The most masculine theme song in wrestling history plays in the arena as the Four Horsemen's music plays on WCW Nitro. Arn Anderson comes to the ring with the Taskmaster for his main event against the Giant, while the British Bulldog goes one-on-one with Jake Roberts on Raw. Davey Boy gets hip-tossed close to the snake and he quickly backs off in fear. Jake continues the assault as Shawn Michaels denies having relations with Diana Smith on commentary. The match stops there as the Bulldog stares at HBK from the ring. Davey then goes to town on Roberts in the corner, but really, Jake the Snake is completely secondary here. This is all about Shawn Michaels and the British Bulldog. Roberts gets kneed by Davey Boy Smith when Jake rushes his opponent in the corner. Davey begins targeting the leg as Jerry Lawler continues to throw accusations at HBK on commentary. More punishment gets delivered to Jake. Roberts' leg gets kicked, punched, wrapped around the ring post, and Davey once again slows the match down by applying a leg submission on the mat. This has been pretty awful so far. Jake fights back with a short arm clothesline. He signals for the DDT, but Davey is right back on the attack. As the Bulldog applies a half Boston Crab, Jerry Lawler announces that Shawn posed for Playgirl magazine this morning. Shawn admits that he did do it and he said it was fun. There's no other way to say it, but this main event match has been absolutely brutal. Davey Boy and Jake Roberts begin stumbling over each other. Davey gets distracted by Michaels and Roberts tries a sneaky pin, but it only gets him a two count. Another half Boston Crab gets applied. Davey again gets distracted, and Jake fails to take advantage this time when he falls to the mat after delivering a single punch. Diana Hart then shows up. She begins giving Sean a mouthful at ringside, and she tries to throw a drink over HBK, but it goes all over the fans instead. Sean decides to take it out on Jim Cornette. Davey jumps on HBK, and Raw goes off the air just like that. We have no idea what happened in the match. No words can explain how bad this was. The worst Raw main event so far on Reliving the War. The Nitro main event may be predictable, but there's no way it can be any worse than Davey Boy Smith versus Jake Roberts. Kevin Sullivan explains to Jimmy Hart that he's only there to make sure AA gets a fair shot at the Giant. What a nice thing to do. AA tries a German suplex, and of course that doesn't work. The Giant doesn't sell any of Anderson's offense in the corner, and the Enforcer takes a body slam in the middle of the ring. Anderson gets Irish whipped from one corner to another. A back body drop is enough to send AA out of the ring, and this match just isn't going Arn's way at all. Anderson is finally able to take advantage when the Giant steps over the top rope. This leads to the Enforcer hitting a few double axe handles. Arn strikes a grounded Giant, and then Anderson announces that he's going for a DDT. AA grabs the Giant's head, but the Giant lifts Arn up into the chokeslam position. The Giant hits his finisher and it's all over. The Giant is still the WCW champion. The show ends with Eric Bischoff announcing that next week's Nitro will be a 2-hour broadcast as Bobby the Brain Heenan takes some of Ric Flair's goodies at the commentary table. Nitro's main event was also a bit crap, but it was still better than Raw's. Nitro scores the final point. The only point Raw got this week was for the Mark Merrow vs Steve Austin match. Nitro got the remaining 4 points. The Flair vs Guerrero match was easily match of the week, and this one comes recommended. With Nitro winning this week's show, our scores are now 14 points to Raw, 16 points to Nitro, and we've had 3 ties. Raw's 5-week winning streak also came to an end in the television ratings. Nitro scored a 3.1, while Raw managed a 2.3. So I put up a poll to get a little feedback on how Reliving the War should continue when Nitro goes to a 2-hour format, and I want to thank everyone who voted and shared their thoughts. While the Meltzer route got the popularity vote, a few other suggestions were made in the comments section. This one here, from a chap named Andrew Fairbanks, suggested that the entire first hour of Nitro should get scored on whether I would have stuck with the WCW show or switch to Raw after the first hour had ended. I actually think this is a great way to continue the show. It's simple, and it allows us to more or less keep the same format. So that's exactly what will happen from next week onwards. We'll see how it fits though, and if it doesn't work, then we'll go the Meltzer route and start scoring individual matches and promos. I'm also going to alter the rules a little in regards to scoring promos and segments. If both segments are bad on Raw and Nitro, then no points will be given, and if both segments are good, then both shows can also score points. Finally, and most importantly, I also want to thank everyone for continuing to watch Reliving the War. The enthusiasm you guys have for this show makes it all worthwhile, and now that we have gotten over the initial period of the Monday Night War, things are only going to get better from this point onwards. A happy new year to you all, another huge thank you for sticking with me, and I'll see you all next week.